I can remember the months of November and December were filled for me with peculiar joys, so different from those of other boys.
For other boys would be counting the days till end of term and holiday times, but I was acting in Christmas plays while they were taken to pantomimes.
I never cared who scored the goal or which side won the silver cup. I never learnt to bat or bowl, but I heard the curtain going up.
That was Noel Coward writing about his own childhood.
And for the next 60 years, Noel Coward heard the curtain going up.
And up.
And up.
And up.
And up. Until, as he himself once said, it created a positive draft.
So tonight we'd like to give you some idea of what went on while the curtain was up.
In words and music by the master.
The sun is shining where clouds have been. Maybe it's something to do with spring.
I feel no older than 17.
Maybe it's something to do with spring.
Or something I can't express.
A kind of lute in the air.
A lyrical loveliness
seems everywhere.
That sheep's behavior is just obscene.
Maybe it's something to do with some crazy something to do with.
Maybe it's something to do with spring, spring, ring-a-ding.
Look at us three representatives, we have a nation renowned for virility.
We formed a cult of puerility, just for fun.
You may deplore the effects of war that are causing the world to decay a bit.
We found our place and will play a bit, in the sun.
Though Waterloo was won upon the playing fields of Eton,
the next war will be photographed and lost
by Cecil Beaton.
Bright young people ready to do it to dare.
We casually strive to keep London alive from Chelsea to Bloomsbury Square.
We give lovely parties that last through the night.
I dress as a woman and scream with delight.
We wake up at lunchtime and find we're still tight.
And what could be duller than that? Bright young people,
don't think our lives are not full.
No, I make little hats from Victorian mats.
Yes, and I work with tinfoil and wool. It's divine.
Our critics are often excessively rude. To one of my portraits, they always allude. It's me worked in beads upside down, in the nude.
And what could be duller than that?
Psychology experts we often perplex.
Yes, and doctors have warned us we'll end up as wrecks.
But they get a degree if they find out our sex.
And what could be duller than that?
Poor little rich girl, you're a bewitched girl, better beware. Laughing at danger,
virtue a stranger,
better take care. The life you lead sets all your nerves a jangle.
Your love affairs are in a hopeless tangle.
Though you're a child here, your life's a wild typhoon. In lives of leisure, the craze for pleasure steadily grows.
Cocktails and laughter.
But what comes after, nobody knows. You're weaving love into a mad jazz pattern, ruled by pantaloon. Poor little rich girl, don't drop a stitch too soon.
Play to me beneath the summer moon. Zigeuner, zigeuner, zigeuner. All I ask of life is just to listen to the songs that you sing. My spirit like a bird on the wing. Your melodies adoring, soaring.
Let's look on love as a plaything, all these sweet moments we've known. Then without forgetting happiness that has passed, there'll be no regretting fun that didn't quite last.
This is a changing world, my dear. New songs are sung, new dawns appear. Though we grow older year by year, our hearts can still be gay.
Where are the snows of yesteryear, when winter's gone and spring is here?
No regrets are worth a tear.
We're living in a changing world,
dancing, and the gods must have found it entrancing,
for they smiled on this moment undefiled
by the care and woe that mortals know. We were dancing, and the music and lights were enhancing our desire when the world caught on fire.
When I would dance, 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 lady, you this beat the rhythm beating in your mind.
Dance, 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 the lady so obsessed with second best, no rest you'll ever find.
Tiny, tiny trouble, never, never wait.
Let the cauldron bubble, justify your fate. Dance, 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 the lady, dance, 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 the lady, dance, 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 little lady, dance.
Dance. A room with a view, and you, and no one to worry us,
no one to hurry us through this dream we found.
We'll gaze at the sky and try to guess what it's all about.
Then we will figure out why the world is round. We'll be as happy as
and see. We'll bill and we'll coo, ooh, and sorrow will never come.
Oh, will it ever come true? Difficult to rise above. Sail away.
Sail away.
Sail away.
Sail away.
When your heart feels as weary as a worn out glove, sail away.
Sail away.
Sail away.
To recommend London, particularly Hyde Park, on a sunny afternoon in spring when the grass is newly green and there's a feeling of lightness in the air. Subconsciously affected by this, the most prosaic citizens frequently give way to a certain abandon. Fathers of families take off their coats and waistcoats and lie on their backs, gazing at the sky. Their wives sit near them, keeping an eye on the children and allowing the sun to burn semicircular areas of pink onto their necks. Younger people lie unashamedly close, sometimes asleep, sometimes lazily awake, murmuring laconically to each other, sucking sweets, smoking cigarettes, relaxed and content, soothed into the sensual lassitude by the promise in the air and the gentle weather. As a general rule, decorum is observed, although occasionally passion flames suddenly between them, and they lie arms and legs entwined, oblivious of passers-by, lost in brief ecstasy. Police constables regulate these transient excesses with admirable discretion. Nothing is allowed to get out of control. The decencies are upheld. The birds sing, the cries of children, the barking of dogs, the far-off strains of a military band, together with the incessant rumble of the traffic in the distance, provide a muted orchestration to this unremarkable, and yet at the same time, unique, London pastoral.
Your feet are frozen. That old bloody football team had its feet frozen.
Now, love it, what a fair game.
Oh, fair game, that'll come off it. 22 frozen feet trying to play football.
Well, they did get one goal.
One goal? That's what they got, one goal. One of their men fell over laughing, kicked the ball in his own net.
Yeah, well, you'll be home soon. You have a nice cup of tea and a sit down.
Yeah.
If I ever sit down again.
What?
My bum's numb,
oh,
too.
Come on,
well,
shut
it
up.
Is.
Now, where is that? Where is that bus, then?
Oh, I do hope we didn't miss it.
No, my God, so do I. I tell you, Beryl, the last time I missed this bus, this very bus, I had to wait 3/4 of an hour for another.
Oh, Lord.
Yeah. And a dog bit me.
Now, Fred, remember, we are British.
Hmm?
It's being so cheerful as keeps us going.
You're right, Beryl. You're not wrong, you're right. Come on then, lass, up at the corners,
that's
what I say, up at the corners.
That's it.
We are told very loudly and often to lift up our hearts.
We are told that good humour will soften fate's cruelest darts.
So however bad our
domestic troubles may be, we just shake with amusement and sing with glee.
Hey, how? Mum's got those pains again.
Granny's in bed with her varicose veins again.
Everyone's gay because dear cousin Florrie were run down on Saturday night by a lorry.
We're so thrilled. Elsie's miscarriage occurred on the Wednesday after her marriage.
When Albert fell down all the steps of the town hall, he got 3 bad cuts and a bruise.
We're delighted to be able to say we're unable to pay off our debts.
Oh, oh, we're excited because Rover's got mange and we've run up a bill at the vet.
Three cheers!
Poor little Sydney has got a spectacular stone in his kidney.
Now he's at 7.
So God's in his heaven.
And that is the end of the news. Oh, now we're at that bleeding bus bell, for God's sake.
Oh, you don't suppose they're on strike, do you?
Oh, my God, not another one. Oh, Lord, it were the dockers last week.
And the plumbers a week before that.
Yes. And the Queen ain't feeling too hot either, I'll tell you.
What a catastrophe! Grandfather's brain is beginning to atrophy.
Last Sunday night, after eating an apple, he made a rude noise in the Methodist chapel.
Now, don't laugh. Poor Mrs. Mason was washing some smalls in her lavatory basin when that old corroded gas heater exploded and blew her smack into the mews.
We've been done in by that mortgage foreclosure, eh? And Father went out on the blind. He got run in for an indecent exposure and ever so heavily fined. Hey, how I'm little diddle, Aunt Isabel Shingles have met in the middle.
She's buried in heaven.
So go to his heaven, and that is the end of the news. Oh, we missed that bloody bastard. It's all your fault.
The stately homes of England we proudly represent. We only keep them up for Americans to rent. Though the pipes of supply, the bathroom burst, and the lavatory makes you fear the worst, it was used by Charles I, quite informally, and later by George IV. On a journey north, the state apartments keep their historical renown. It's wiser not to sleep there in case they tumble down. But still, if they ever catch on fire, which with any luck they might, we'll fight for the stately homes of England.
The stately homes of England, though rather in the lurch, provide a lot of chances for psychical research. There's the ghost of a crazy younger son who murdered in 1351 an extremely rowdy nun who resented it, and people who come to call meet her in the hall. The baby in the guest wing who crouches by the grate was walled up in the west wing in 1428. And if anyone spots the Queen of Scots in a hand-embroidered shroud, we're proud of the stately homes of England.
The stately homes of England, although a trifle bleak, historically speaking, are more or less unique.
We've a cousin who won the Golden Fleece,
and a very peculiar fowling piece that was sent to Cromwell's niece,
who detested it and rapidly sent it back with a dirty crack.
A note we have from Chaucer contains a bawdy joke.
We also have a saucer the Bloody Mary broke.
We've 2 pairs of tights, King Arthur's knights are completely worn away.
Sing hey for the stately homes of England.
City flower, every spring unfailing, growing in the crevices by some London railing. Though it has a Latin name, in town and country. countryside. We in England call it London Pride. London Pride has been handed down to us. London Pride is a flower that's free. London Pride means our own dear town to us, and our pride it forever will be. Oh, Liza, see the costabarrows, vegetable marrows, and the fruit piled high. Oh, Liza, little London sparrow, Covent Garden Market, where the costers cry. Cockney feet mark the beat of history. Every street pins a memory down. Nothing ever can break or harm the charm of London town.
We must all be very kind to Auntie Jessie, for she's never been a mother or a wife. You mustn't throw your toys at her or make a vulgar noise at her. She hasn't led a very happy life. You must never fill her nightdress case with beetles or whip her Horlicks malted milk to foam. And though her kiss is worse than death, it is rude to hold your breath, for charity, we hope, begins at home.
Hello, 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 hello.
Hello, Barbara.
Hello, Jamie. You're having a good time?
Very nice indeed, you?
Ah, yes. It's a pretty theatre, isn't it?
It's a lovely theatre. It's a very nice audience, too.
Yes, they are.
I think we have the carriage trade in tonight.
See, Lisa, what was he going on about?
His Auntie Jessie.
Auntie Jessie?
His Auntie Jessie.
Auntie Jessie! How boring.
Well, we all of us have relations.
You've heard it 1,000 times.
Our relatives were not excessively bright.
They love to go off on missions to rather peculiar climes and lead the wretched heathen to the light.
A few of them got beaten up in the course of these rampages.
My great-aunt Maud got eaten up while singing the Rock of Ages.
These family obligations admittedly are a bore.
But there is just one uncle.
Ah, yes.
That we positively adore.
Poor Uncle Harry, I wanted to be a missionary, so we took a ship and sailed away.
This visionary,
hotly pursued by dear Aunt Mary,
found a South Sea isle on which to stay.
The natives treated them kindly and invited them to dine
on yams and clams and human hams and vintage coconut wines.
The taste of which was filthy, but the after effects divine.
Poor Uncle Harry got a bit gay and longed to tarry.
This Aunt Mary couldn't quite allow.
She lectured him severely on a number of church affairs.
But when she'd gone to bed, he made a getaway down the stairs.
For he longed to find the answer to a few of the maiden's prayers.
Uncle Harry's not the missionary now.
Poor Uncle Harry,
after a chat with dear Aunt Mary, thought the time had come to make a row.
He lined up all the elder girls in one of the local sheds.
And while he was reviling them and tearing himself to shreds,
they took their mother hubbards off and they tied them around their heads.
Uncle Harry's not the missionary now.
He's
certainly not a missionary now.
Second verse coming right up.
From the top.
Now Uncle was just a seeker, a dreamer sincerely blessed. Of this there couldn't be a shadow of doubt.
The fact that his flesh was weaker than even Aunt Mary guessed took even her some time to figure out.
In all these languid latitudes, the atmosphere's exotic.
To take up moral attitudes would be too idiotic.
Though nobody could be meeker than Uncle had been before,
I'll bet today he's giving way
at practically every pore.
Poor Uncle Harry,
having become a missionary, found the natives' morals rather crude.
He
and Aunt Mary
swiftly imposed an arbitrary ban upon them shopping in the nude.
They all considered this silly. They didn't take it well.
They burnt his boots and several suits and wrecked a mission hotel.
They also burnt his Macintosh, which made a disgusting smell.
Poor Uncle Harry,
after some words with dear Aunt Mary, called upon the chiefs for a powwow.
They didn't brandish knives at him. They really were awfully sweet.
They made concerted dives at him and offered him things to eat.
But when they threw their wives at him, he had to admit defeat.
Uncle Harry's not the missionary now.
Poor dear Aunt Mary, though it was revolutionary, thought her time had come to take a bow.
Poor Uncle Harry looked at her, in whom he had placed his trust.
His very last illusion broke and crumbled away to dust.
For she placed a flower behind each ear. And frankly, exposed her bust.
Uncle Harry's not a missionary now.
He left the islands,
but he's certainly not a missionary.
I was born, writes Noel Coward, into a world that took light music seriously. The lyrics and melodies of the Edwardian era were hummed and strummed into my consciousness from an early age. My mother played them, my father sang them, my nurse Emma breathed them through her teeth while she was washing me and putting me to bed. My uncles and aunts, who were legion, sang them singly and in unison at the slightest provocation. Well, I'm afraid it's the same with us. Ladies and gentlemen, may we now present a Noel Coward Music Hall.
Chase me, Charlie, chase me, Charlie, over the garden wall. I'd like to wander for miles and miles, wreathed in smiles, out on the tiles with you. Chase me, Charlie, chase me, Charlie, don't be afraid to fall. Her love in the moonlight can be sublime. Now's the time, Charlie, I'm waiting for you if you'd only climb over the garden wall.
Saturday night at the Rose and Crown is just the place to be. And soldiers and sailors all out for a bit of a spree. If you find that you're weary of life with your trouble and strife, and the kids have got you down, it will all come right on Saturday night at the Rose and Crown.
On the island of Ballamazoo, life is almost too good to be true. You can fish on the reef wearing pearls and a leaf, which at Brighton you never could do. You don't have to care what the neighbours might think if some charming young lady should give you a wink. You can buy her outright for the price of a drink
on the island of Ballamazoo.
What-o, Mrs. Brisket? Why not take a plunge and risk it? The water's warm and there ain't no crabs, and you'll have a lot of fun among the shrimps and dabs. If for a lark some saucy old shark takes a nibble at your chocolate biscuit, woo! Swim for the shore and the crowd will roar.
What-o, Mrs. Brisket? Oh, what-o, Mrs. Brisket? Why not take a plunge and risk it? The water's warm and there ain't no crabs, and you'll have a lot of fun among the shrimps and dabs. If for a lark some saucy old shark takes a nibble at your chocolate biscuit, swim for the shore and the crowd will roar. What a Mrs. Brisket! Diddle-lum-bum, diddle-lum-bum-bum, diddle-lum-bum, bum-bum. Has anybody seen our ship? The HMS Disgusting. We've been on shore for a month or more, and when we see the captain we shall get one for. Heave-ho, me hearties, the quarter-deck beats dustin'.
We had a binge last Christmas year.
some nice plum puddings and a round of beer.
But the captain pulled his cracker and we cried, oh dear.
Has anybody seen our ship?
Oi!
As we stroll down
Piccadilly in the bright morning air, all the gals turn and stare.
We're so nonchalant
and frightfully debonair
as we chat to Rose, Maud or Lily. You should see the way their boyfriends frown,
for they know without a doubt that the luck's right out, up against the couple of men about town. As we doff hats, each a pretty filly gives a wink at us and then looks down. For they long with all their might for a red hot night when they see a couple of men about, see a couple of men about, see a couple of men about.
For a humble deserves, one can betray her troubles never, whatever occurs. Though I never really grumble, life's a jumble indeed, and in my effort to succeed, I've had to formulate a creed. I believe in doing what I can, in crying when I must, in laughing when I choose. Hey ho! If love were all, I should be lonely. I believe the more you love a man, the more you give your trust, the more you're bound to lose. Although, when shadows fall, I think, if only somebody splendid really needed me, someone affectionate and dear, cares would be ended if I knew that he wanted to have me. I believe that since my life began, the most I've had is just a talent to amuse. Hey ho, if love were
my passion for travel, writes Noel Coward, has remained undimmed throughout the years. However, I am always too early or too late. I arrive in Japan just when the cherry blossoms have gone. I arrive in China just before the next revolution. I ride the golden road to Samarkand, but it's summer and it stinks. People are always telling me about something that I've just missed. I find this very, very restful.
Travel, they say, improves the mind.
An irritating platitude, and frankly, entre nous, very far from true.
Personally, I've yet to find that longitude and latitude can educate those scores of monumental bores.
There isn't a rock between Bangkok and the beaches of Hispaniola
that does not recoil from suntan oil
and the gurgle of Coca-Cola.
Why do the wrong people travel, travel, travel when the right people stay back home?
What compulsion compels them?
And who the hell tells them to drag the cans to Zanzibar instead of staying quietly in Omaha?
In the smallest street where the gourmets meet, they invariably will fetch up.
And it's hard to make them accept a steak that isn't served burned and smeared with ketchup.
Please do not think that we criticize or cavil at the genuine urge to roam. But why, oh why, do the wrong people travel when the right people stay back home?
Send out more pizza
when the right people stay back home.
Let's have some spare ribs
when the right people stay back home. Why do the wrong people travel, travel, travel when the right people stay back home?
What explains this mass mania to leave Pennsylvania and clack about like flocks of geese?
Demanding dry martinis on the Isles of Greece.
They will take a train
or an aeroplane
for an hour on the Costa Brava.
And they'll see Pompeii on the only day that it's up to its arse in molten lava.
Millions of tourists are churning up the gravel as they gaze at St. Peter's Dome.
Right people stay back home.
Let's have chop suey
when the right people stay back home.
With lots of egg rolls
when the right people stay back home. We're merely asking when the right people stay back home.
Yes!
When you take a trip on a boat or ship, look carefully around you, for ravening hordes of smiling frauds are certain to surround you. We're off to sea today. Hooray, hooray, hooray! Smiles,
grace,
charm,
tact. We never forget one vital fact.
The passenger's always right, my boys, the passenger's always right.
The son of a bitch is probably rich, so smile with all your might.
Be wiser than a monkey.
Be on to all his tricks.
If one of them's a junkie,
give him a break.
Give him a fix.
The passenger may be sober, boys.
The passenger may be tight.
He may have a yen for raw recruits.
Or mountain goats.
Or football boots.
Smooth him,
soothe him, and adieu him morning, noon, and night. The passenger's always right. The passenger's always right, my boys. The passenger's always right.
He may pay a price for curious vice.
Or merely want to fight.
He may have inhibitions.
And yearn for secret joys.
Obey your intuitions.
Offer him girls.
Offer him boys.
The passenger may be dumb, my boys.
Or terribly erudite.
Perhaps you can satisfy his needs with strings of rather nasty beads.
Compel him, sell him, anything from sex to dynamite. Remember, boys, the goddamn passenger's always wrong.
Don't put your daughter on the stage, Mrs. Worthington.
Don't put your daughter on the stage.
She's a bit of an ugly duckling, you must honestly confess.
and the width of her seat would surely defeat her chances of success.
It's a loud voice, and though it's not exactly flat, she'll need a little more than that to earn a living wage. On my knees, Mrs. Worthington.
Please, Mrs. Worthington, don't put your daughter on the stage. Don't put your daughter on the stage, Mrs. Worthington. Don't put your daughter on the stage.
Though they said at the School of Acting she was lovely as Peer Gynt,
I'm afraid on the whole an ingenue role would emphasize her squint.
She's a big girl, and though her teeth are fairly good, she's not the type I ever would be eager to engage. No more butts, Mrs. Worthington.
Nuts, Mrs. Worthington. Don't put your daughter on the stage. Don't put your daughter on the stage, Mrs. Worthington. Don't put your daughter on the stage.
Why, look at her bandy legs, Bruce. She doesn't stand a chance.
In addition to which, the son of a bitch can neither sing nor dance.
She's a vile girl, and uglier than mortal sin. The thought of her has put me in a tearing bloody rage. That suffice, Mrs. Worthington.
Christ, Mrs. Worthington, don't put your daughter on the stage.
In tropical climes, there are certain times of day when all the citizens retire to tear their clothes off and perspire.
It's one of those rules the greatest fools obey, because the sun is much too sultry and one must avoid its ultraviolet ray.
The natives grieve when the white men leave their huts, because they're obviously, definitely nuts.
Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
The Japanese don't care to.
The Chinese wouldn't dare to.
Hindus and Argentines sleep firmly from 12 to 1.
But Englishmen detest a siesta.
In the Philippines, there are lovely screens to protect you from the glare.
In the Malay states, there are hats like plates the Britishers won't wear.
At 12 noon, the natives swoon and no further work is done.
But mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
It's such a surprise for the Eastern eyes to see that though the English are effete, they're quite impervious to heat.
When the white man rides, every native hides in glee, because the simple creatures hope he will impale his solar topi on a tree.
It seems such a shame when the English claim the earth that they give rise to such hilarity and mirth.
Ha, 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 mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
The toughest Burmese bandit can never understand it.
In Rangoon, the heat of noon is just what the natives shun.
They put their scotch or rye down and lie down.
In a jungle town where the sun beats down to the rage of man and beast,
the English garb of the English Tsar merely gets a bit more creased.
In Bangkok at 12 o'clock, they foam at the mouth and run.
But mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun. Mad dogs and Englishmen go out in the midday sun.
The smallest Malay rabbit deplores a stupid habit.
In Hong Kong, they strike a gong and fire off a noonday gun
to reprimand each inmate who's in late.
In the mangrove swamps where the python romps, there is peace from 12 till 2.
Even caribous lie around and snooze. There's nothing else to do.
In Bengal, to move at all is seldom, if ever, done.
But mad dogs and Englishmen go out to the midday, 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 out to the midday sun.
Lord,
what was all that?
Oh, I may faint.
I have been to a marvelous party with Nunu and Nada and Nell. It was in the fresh air, and we went as we were, and we stayed as we were, which was hell. Dear Grace started singing at midnight and did not stop singing till 4. Still, we knew some excitement was bound to begin when Doris got blind on Dubonnet and gin. and scratched her veneer with a Cartier pin. I couldn't have liked it more. I have been to a marvelous party, and I must say, the fun was intense. We all had to do what the people we knew might be doing 100 years hence. Dear Cecil arrived wearing armor, some shells, and a black feather boa. Poor Millicent. Oh, poor Millicent. She wore a surrealist comb made of bits of mosaic from St. Peter's in Rome. But the weight was so great that she had to go home. I couldn't have liked it more. I have been to a marvelous party. I mean, we didn't start dinner till 10. Oh, and young Bobby Carr did a stunt at the bar with a lot of extraordinary men. Dear Baba arrived with a turtle. Shattered us all to the core. The Grand Duke was boring the hell out of B when suddenly Cyril cried, "Oh, fiddly-dee," and ripped off his trousers and jumped in the sea. Well, I couldn't have liked it more. I have been to a marvellous party. Elise made an entrance with May. Oh, you'd never have guessed from her fisherman's vest that her bust had been whittled away. Poor Lulu got fried on Chianti and talked about esprit de corps. Maurice made a couple of passes at Gus, but Billy, who hates any kind of a fuss, did half the Big Apple and twisted his truss. I couldn't have liked it more. Oh, my God, we talked about growing old gracefully. And Elsie, who is 74, well, she said, A, it's a question of being sincere. And B, if you're supple, you've nothing to fear. Then she swung upside down from a glass chandelier. Well, I couldn't have liked it more. As a matter of fact, it really wasn't one of the best parties I think that I've ever been in my entire life. And Noodle and Nardo, they're all coming around later. And we're all going to another party. And I do hope it's going to be as good as the party we went to last time, because it really wasn't one of those happy times I've had around that time.
Are you engaged for this dance?
I was, but my partner was suddenly taken ill.
It's this damn smallpox epidemic.
No. As a matter of fact, it was kidney trouble.
You'll dance it with me, I hope.
I shall be charmed. Have you ever crossed the Sahara on a camel?
Frequently. When I was a boy, we used to do it all the time.
What do you do?
I work in a bank.
High up in a bank? Or just sitting in a cage totting up things?
Quite high up, really. It's a very good bank.
I'm so glad.
Quite a good floor, isn't it?
I think it needs a little borax.
I love borax.
I think life is for living, don't you?
It's difficult to know what else you'd do with it.
Delightful parties Lady Bundle always gives, doesn't she?
Entrancing. Such a dear old lady.
And so gay. Did you notice her at supper, blowing all those shrimps through her ear trumpet?
Delicious looking ham on the supper table.
Yes. She has its special descent from Scotland.
Why Scotland?
It lives there when it's alive.
Is that the Grand Duchess Olga, lying under the piano?
Yes. Her husband died a few weeks ago on his way back from Pulborough.
What on earth was he doing in Pulborough?
Well, nobody knows exactly. But there have been the usual rumours.
I see.
I lent that woman the top of my thermos flask. And she never returned it. She's shallow. That's what she is. Shallow.
That orchestra has a remarkably small repertoire.
They don't seem to know anything but this, do they?
Are you engaged for this dance?
I was, but my partner was suddenly taken ill.
Is this damn smallpox epidemic?
No. As a matter of fact, it was kidney trouble.
You'll dance it with me, I hope.
I shall be charmed. That hedge over there is called Cupressus macrocarpa.
Do you swear to it?
Strange how potent cheap music is.
Was it in the real world, or was it in a dream? Was it just a note in some eternal theme? Was it accidental? Or accurately planned? How could I hesitate, knowing that my fate led me by the hand? You were there. I saw you and my heart stopped beating. You were there. And in that first enchanted meeting, life changed its tune. The stars, the moon came near to me. Dreams that I dreamed like magic seemed to be clear to me. Dear to me. eyes looked into mine and faltered everywhere. The color of the whole world altered, false became true. My universe tumbled into the earth became heaven for you.
This car hasn't moved in 1¾ hours.
I know.
Couldn't we sneak out and slip in the back way?
I don't believe there is a back way into Buckingham Palace.
Oh, well, there must be. Mm-hmm. They never take the groceries past those sentries.
I can't understand your being so nervous.
Nervous? Oh, I'm petrified. Being presented to the Queen of England. I'd rather face a Monday night audience at the end of the pier.
Oh, relax, darling. Just relax.
Relax? How can I relax with all these people gaping at me?
Well, it'll soon be over.
That woman in the red hat is laughing at me.
Pay no attention.
Well, you just go right ahead and have yourself a good look.
Oh,
and
done,
enjoy
done,
it
done,
while
done,
you're
done,
about it.
Done, please, what's... please.
I'm sorry, but you would think they'd have something better to do.
You really must try to be a little more dignified.
Dignified?
Mm-hmm.
With these three white feathers stuck in my head. I feel like one of the horses in Cinderella.
Oh, keep calm, darling.
Oh, calm, calm. That's all very well for you to say. You were brought up to this. But here am I, a dancing soubrette for 15 years, shoved on in the palace scene without a rehearsal.
Now, darling, please try to forget the theatre for a little.
That is all I have to remember. That and Father's pawn shop. Oh, dear, no, this is not my cup of tea, and I do believe they all know it. I can't help feeling fate's made a fool of me, rather. It's placed me where I shouldn't be, and really couldn't be by rights. We lived at Ealing, me and my mother and father. I've scaled the social ladder, but I've never had a head for heights. We had a pawn shop at the corner of the street, and father did a roaring trade. I used to think those rings and necklaces were sweet. Now, I wouldn't give them to my maid. I've traveled a long, long way. The journey hasn't been all jam. But I must admit, the roads in which I sit is one up on the dear old tram. I say to myself each day, indefinitely, marble horse. Today it may be three white feathers, but yesterday it was three brass balls. I've traveled a long, long way and had a lot of jolts and bumps, but I'll concentrate and be ahead of fate, whichever way the old cat jumps. I'll wink as I slyly drink to the ancestors who line our halls. Today it may be
But yesterday it was three press. We're moving.
So we are.
Oh, I don't want to go in there.
Oh, now, darling.
I don't
darling,
want
come
to
along,
go in
come
there.
Along. Now, come along. Trust me. Trust me. I think you look very lovely. And I'm... Oh, I'm so very proud of you.
My darling. Thank you.
Newspaper reporter was almost in tears. Mr. Coward, Mr. Coward, she cried. Haven't you anything to say to the Star? Well, certainly, said Mr. Coward. Twinkle.
The critic was condescending. Mr. Coward, he said, I'd really prefer your acting to your writing. Oddly enough, said Mr. Coward, that's just the way I feel about you.
She got in a rage about age and retired in a huff from the stage, which taken all round was a pity, because she was still fairly pretty. But she got in a rage about age. She got in a state about weight and resented each morsel she ate. Her colon she constantly sluiced and reduced and reduced and reduced, and at quite an incredible rate put on weight. She got in a rage about age. But she still could have played Mistress Page, and she certainly could have done worse than hay fever or Juliet's nurse. But she got in a rage about age, and she moaned and she wept and she wailed, and she roared and she ranted and railed, and retired, very heavily veiled, from the stage.
She was 14, and I was 12 when I first met her. We were traveling north together to appear in a morality play. She wore a black satin coat and a black velvet military cap with a peak. Her face was far from pretty, but tremendously alive. She was very grown up, carried a handbag with a powder puff, and frequently dabbed her generously turned-up nose. She confided to me that her name was Gertrude Lawrence, but that I was to call her Gert, because everybody did. She then gave me an orange, told me a few mildly dirty stories, and I loved her. From that moment onwards.
Loving is more important than being in love. If one can grow from the other, you're all right. Sometimes it does, sometimes it doesn't. But when it does, you're in for a long run.
I am no good at love. My heart should be wise and free. But I kill the unfortunate golden goose, whoever it may be, with over-articulate tenderness and too much intensity. I am no good at love. I betray it with little sins. For I feel the misery of the end in the moment it begins. And the bitterness of the last goodbye is the bitterness that wins.
I believe now, and have always believed, that there's far too much nonsense talked about sex. To me, the whole business is vastly overrated. I enjoy it for what it's worth, and fully intend going on doing so as long as anybody is interested. But when the time comes when they are not, I shall be perfectly content to settle down with an apple and a good book.
We know God made trees and the birds and the bees and the seas for the fishes to swim in.
We are also aware that he has quite a flair for creating exceptional women.
When Eve said to Adam, "Start calling me madam," the world became much more exciting.
Which turns to confusion the modern delusion that sex is a question of lighting.
I met him at a party just a couple of years ago. He was rather over-hearty and ridiculous. But as I'd seen him on the screen, he cast a certain glow. I basked in his attraction for a couple of hours or so. His manners were a fraction too meticulous. If he was real or not, I couldn't tell. But like a silly fool, I fell. Mad about the boy, it's pretty funny, but I'm mad about the boy. I'm quite ashamed of it, but must admit, the sleepless nights I've had about the boy. Walking down the street, his eyes look out at me from people that I meet. I can't believe it's true, but when I'm blue, in some strange way, I'm glad about the boy. I'm hardly sentimental. Love isn't so sublime. I have to pay my rental, and I can't afford to waste much time. If I could employ a little magic that would finally destroy this dream that pains me and enchains me, but I can't, because I'm mad about the boy. Lord knows I'm not a fool girl. I really shouldn't care. Lord knows I'm not a schoolgirl in the flurry of her first affair. Will it ever cloy, this odd diversity of misery and joy? I'm feeling quite insane and young again, and I'm because
a few years ago, the National Enquirer devoted its entire front page to Noel Coward. And there, under a photograph of him, looking no more dapper than usual, came this rather startling headline. Noel Coward says, I could take Elizabeth Taylor away from Richard Burton. I am the sexiest man alive. Well, as he has also remarked on many other occasions, it's the thought that counts.
Senorita Nina from Argentina knew all the answers, although her relatives and friends were perfect dancers. She swore she'd never dance a step until she died. She said, I've seen too many movies, and all they prove is too idiotic. They all insist that South America's exotic, whereas it couldn't be more boring if it tried. She said that frankly she was blinded to all their over-advertised romantic charms. And then she got more bloody-minded and told them where to put their tropic palms. She said, I hate to be pedantic, but it drives me nearly frantic when I see that unromantic, sycophantic lot of sluts forever wriggling their guts. It drives me absolutely nuts. She declined to begin the begin when they requested it, and she made an embarrassing scene if anyone suggested it, for she detested it. Though no one ever could be keener than little Nina on quite a number of very eligible men who did the rumba, when they proposed to her, she merely left them flat.
She said that love should be impulsive and not convulsive, and syncopation had a discouraging effect on procreation, and that she'd rather read a book, and that was that. She refused to begin or begin when they besought her to, and with language profane and obscene she cast the man who taught her to. She cast Kel Porter too. From this it's fairly clear that Nina, in her demeanor, was so offensive that when the hatred of her friends grew too intensive, she thought she'd better beat it while she had the chance. After some trial and tribulation, she reached the station and met a sailor who had acquired a wooden leg in Venezuela, and so she married him because he couldn't dance. There surely never could have been a more irritating girl than Nina. They never speak in Argentina of this degenerate bambina who had the luck to find romance and resolutely wouldn't dance. She wouldn't dance, ole.
I'll sing you a song. It's not very long. Its moral may disconcert you. It's about a mother and wife who for most of her life was famed for domestic virtue. She had two strapping daughters and a rather dull son and a much duller husband who at 61 elected to retire and later on expire. Sing hallelujah, hey nonny no, hey nonny no, hey nonny no. He joined the feathered choir. Having laid him to rest by special request in the family mausoleum, as his widow repaired to the home they had shared, her heart sang a gay te deum. And then, in the middle of the funeral wake, with her mouth full of excellent Madeira cake, she briskly cried, "That's done. My life's at last begun. Sing hallelujah, hey nolly no, hey nolly no, hey nolly no. It's time I had some fun. Today, though hardly a jolly day, at least has set me free. Now, let's all have a lovely holiday on the island of Capri. In a bar on the Piccola Marina, life called to Mrs. Wentworth Brewster. Fate beckoned her and introduced her into a rather queer, unfamiliar atmosphere. She'd just sit there, propping up the bar beside a fisherman who sang to a guitar. When accused of having gone too far, she merely cried, "Funiculi, just fancy me, funicula." When he bellowed, "Che bella signorina!" Sheer ecstasy at once produced a wild shriek from Mrs. Wentworth Brewster, changing her whole demeanor. When both her daughters and her son said, "Please come home, Mama," she answered rather bibulously, "Who do you think you are? Nobody can afford to be so lardy bloody da." In a bar on the Piccola Marina, every fisherman cried, "Viva, viva, and che ragazza!" When she sat on the grand piazza, everybody would rise. Every fisherman sighed, "Oh, viva, viva, che bel inglese!" Someone even said, "Whoops-a-daisy," which was quite a surprise. Each evening, with some light excuse, and beaming with goodwill, she'd just slip into something loose and tottered on the hill to that bar on the Piccola Marina, where love came to Mrs. Wentworth Brewster. Hot flushes of delight suffused her. Right round the bend she went to picture her astonishment. Day in, day out, she would gad about because she felt she was no longer on the shelf. Night out, night in, knocking back the gin, she cried, "Hurrah, funiculi, funicula, oh, funic yourself." Just for fun, three young sailors from Messina bowed low to Mrs. Wentworth Brewster, said "scusi," and abruptly goosed her. Then there was quite a scene. Her family in floods of tears said, "Leave these men, Mama."
She said, "Why? I mean, they're just high-spirited, like all Italians are. And most of them have a great deal more to offer than Papa. In a bar on the Piccola Marina."
When I'm feeling dreary and blue, I'm only too glad to be left alone. Dreaming of a place in the sun when day is done, far from the telephone. Because I'm world-weary, world-weary, living in a great big town, I find it so dreary, so dreary. Everything looks gray or brown.
I want an ocean blue,
great big trees,
a bird's eye view of the Pyrenees.
We want to watch the moon rise up and see the great red sun go down. Watching clouds go by through a wintry sky fascinates us. But when we're standing in the street, every cop we meet simply hates us. Because we're world-weary, world-weary. We could kiss the railroad tracks. We wanna get right back to nature. Assume a horizontal stature. We wanna get right back to nature. And relax.
Mr. Irving Berlin often emphasizes sin in a charming way.
Noel Coward, we know, wrote a song or two to show that sex was here to stay.
Richard Rogers, it's true, took a more romantic view of the sly biological urge.
But it really was Cole who contrived to make the whole thing merge.
He said that Belgians and Greeks do it.
Nice young men who sell antiques do it.
Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
In Texas, some of the men do it.
Others drill a hole and then do it.
Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
E. Allan Poe, ho, 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 did it. But he did it in verse.
H. Beecher Stowe did it. But she had to rehearse.
Aretha Franklin with soul does it.
Julia Child in a Castle Row does it.
Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
Miss America under the flag does it.
The man from Glad with a little bag does it.
Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
The Royal Ballet to a man do it.
Tinkerbell and Peter Pan do it.
Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
Each Miss Gabor, time and again, does it. They keep trying, God knows.
Lawrence Welk, with champagne, does it. But the bubbles get up his nose.
They say that every hormone does it.
Mr. Mr. Portnoy all alone, does it?
Let's do it. Let's fall in love.
Miss Doris Day won't do it. She thinks it offends.
Ferranti and Taisha don't do it. They're just very good friends.
Snow White felt that she must do it. Seven dwarfs could only just do it.
The songs we sung when love in our hearts was young, where in the limbo of the swiftly passing years lie all our hopes and dreams and fears.
Someday I'll find you, moonlight behind you, true to the dream I am dreaming. As I draw near you, you'll smile a little smile. For a little while, we shall stand hand in hand.
I'll follow my secret heart, my whole life. Till one comes true. No matter what price is paid, what stars may fade above, I'll follow my secret heart till I find.
For I believe that since my life began, the most I've had is just a talent to amuse. Hey ho, if love were all.
Play, orchestra, play. Something light and sweet and gay. For we must have music, we must have music to drive our fears away.
While our illusions swiftly fade from us,
let's have an orchestra score.
In the confusion the years have made for us,
serenade for us just once more.
Life needn't be gray, although it's changing day by day. Though a few old dreams may decay. Orchestra play, orchestra play.